podcast pre-show. Super excited, super impromptu, but hello, so was that news from STARZ yesterday.
Yeah.
So Blake and I, when we got the news about 7B announcement, we started to chat, and then we were like, you know what? We just need to record a podcast episode because we have so much to talk about. There's so much being said across the interwebs that we also want to be tapping into that we said, let's table our conversation.
Yes.
Let's wait till the kids are in school. Let's find a little bit that we can time to podcast. So thank you for joining in. Do us a favor, share this podcast into any of your Outlander groups, any of your Outlander friends, because we know that we all want to talk about this. We could be reading some of your comments live on the podcast, of course. And if you do share it, please comment below, je sais pas. I am ready. And yeah, as the podcast pre-show, I'm going to have a very awkward 10 seconds of silence
in
a
moment. As we always do.
As we always do, so Blake can catch the room tone. So please forgive me. Take this time to drop below when you learned about the release date. From which media source? Was it STARZ itself, the Outlander pages, any other pages that you learned about the released, not date, release month? And I'll be awkwardly quiet for 10 seconds.
All right, 10 seconds for...
room tone. From Providence, Rhode Island, welcome to Outlander Cast. It's a podcast dedicated to the show Outlander on STARZ.
Sing me a song of a lass that is gone. Mary of soul, she sailed on a day over the sea, day sky.
Hi, everybody, and welcome back. My name is Mary Larson.
My name is Blake, and you know, I thought I would keep the Sinead O'Connor version of our intro here. You know, it's fitting. We're talking about season 7. We're having fun with it. We're ready to go. The Sinead O'Connor, why not? I'm in. Because normally when we're between seasons, I go back to the original.
The OG. I agree.
But I thought that this would be a good fit for today. Because, you know, we're in the spirit of things.
We are in the spirit. I mean, do you see what I'm wearing? Those of you who are able to watch the video component live or on YouTube afterwards, I am wearing Claire coat.
There you are.
A la season 1. And I felt like this was fitting as well. You know, we've got many items of Outlander clothing between the two of our closets.
So many.
You're wearing one right now, Just a Frank in a World from of Jamie's.
Yes.
T-shirts available at themaryandblakestore.com. But yeah, we're here because we love Outlander. You're listening and tuning in because you love Outlander.
Yes.
And the truth of the matter is, my friends, we got some random and yet amazing and also thought-provoking news yesterday that we needed to talk about, and so we're here for it.
Yeah, you know, we as Mary, I think, said earlier, we heard the news and we just decided, you know what, let's have an impromptu podcast about it, because I think it's something that's worth talking about, Mary, on multiple levels, and the range. Well, you know what, let's just get into the episode, shall we? All right, let's do it. All right, Marvin. So here's the deal. There's a lot.
There's so much. In what, 24 hours at this point?
Yeah, there's a lot going on here, and the range of reaction to the news that STARZ has announced the release window for Outlander to be November of 24.
The range of news.
Well, the range of reaction,
okay.
I think, is pretty wild. I the only other time that I saw this kind of reaction was like The Sopranos, because they did the same thing. They took the final season and split it into two, and there was about a year worth of length in between the two halves. So, well, let's just...
I'll tell you this.
We can talk about everybody else, but Mary, give me your take on this
first.
We're just going for it.
Well,
just give me your take.
Let's have the FAQs first, in case someone is tuning in and they're getting this news first from the Outlander cast podcast of Mary and Blake. Friends, 7B, quotations, 7B of Outlander, season 7, the back half, is set to come out, drumroll... November 2024. This was announced on the STARZ Instagram page on Thursday, March 21st.
Yeah.
Then it was spread through various STARZ-related media outlets and then through other Outlander channels and fandoms and friend to friend. And here we are. And, okay. So, how do we find about this news ourselves, Blake? How did you learn of it? Was it me?
No. I saw it... How did I see it? I saw it on...
Because I texted you it.
Actually, yes, you did. You called me.
Oh, yes, I did.
You called me, and I had a reaction the second that you told me.
Yes.
And you know what? You know, here on Mary and Blake Media, we tell the truth. We tell the truth.
Yes, we do.
And you know, we give our opinions.
Unlike STARZ.
And my... Mary, what was the first word that came out of my mouth when you said it to me? Do you remember?
No, I don't. Because I think I was still so shocked that I couldn't actually digest your reaction.
The first word that came out of my mouth goes in line with...
Didn't you say balls?
No. It was one word.
Okay.
It goes along the lines of Buzz, your girlfriend.
Oh, you said woof.
Woof. That was my first reaction. Woof.
It was woof. You're right.
And Mary, I think she co-signed on that assessment. But tell me your take on all of this, Mary.
You're jumping in with me. Okay.
Yeah, let's go, man. We're here. We're ready. We tell the truth of Mary and Blake Media.
We do.
I don't sugarcoat it for nobody.
Okay, so we do tell the truth. And for those of you who know me, I'm usually an eternal optimist. I also like to see multiple sides of a story. And I think that that's where I'm at right now. I will be completely honest with you. I am on the woof side, the what in the world, choking on this side.
Yeah.
Selfishly, because I want to have a finale party for season 7. And I have been dropping hints about this, and I've been talking a lot about it with Blake and some close friends. And ain't nobody gonna want to come to Rhode Island at Christmas.
Yeah.
Okay? Unless you already have to come to Rhode Island at Christmas. We all have enough travel plans, and you don't want to book a flight to New England when there's blizzards. Okay? So now I'm really bummed. Plus, let's look at the track record when it comes to STARZ releasing shows of our beloved kind. They have random weeks off.
Yes.
And then sometimes they are like, oh, it's a holiday weekend. We're just going to skip this week. And then other times it's like, it's a holiday weekend. We don't care. So it would be so hard to plan. Plus, it's the holiday time. So for me, as someone who's been looking forward to a spring or maybe summer announcement where I thought perfect time for people to come to Rhode Island and have a little party to celebrate, I'm really bummed. Getting through Droughtlander, a lot of it has been me just like thinking about a finale party. So I'm bummed in that sense that it's not going to be as easy to plan. The other thing that I've been shocked about is the timing that they did this. So like I said, I was bummed because I really thought it was going to be coming out a lot sooner. I wanted to hang out with a lot of you. I am shocked that they didn't announce anything on Christmas with a new Yule log. I am shocked they didn't announce anything on Valentine's Day and let us know about one of our favorite couples. Then there came this week. We had the spring friggin' equinox. Okay,
yeah.
Time travelers.
Ugh.
We had the spring equinox with which they could have made at least some kind of a fun, magical announcement. And instead, we get it a couple days after. No one did their job. No one who planned this has watched Outlander, knows anything about standing stones. Get the hell out of here.
Not great, Bob.
And puts it as an Instagram post and says November. Okay. Mm.
And it, oh.
I'm digesting, and the optimist side of me is thankful. It's a great month to be grateful for things. Watching Outlander, snuggled up, having some hot cocoa in a little warm blankie, fantastic. Love it, okay?
Love that for you.
I love watching Outlander in the fall. You can't get sure. more beautiful a palette. So I'm thankful it's coming at all.
Yeah.
But that was my initial reaction, okay? I was upset because I don't think people are going to want to come here in the mysterious December, maybe January, if they
Nobody
push it back
Nobody wants to
some
come to Rhode
weeks.
Island no. in that time period.
We've already had two parties in the winter, okay? It's difficult. And then I'm just very disappointed with the lack of magical timing that they could have potentially even had.
Yeah.
Those are my initial reactions. Blake, how about yours?
So I have a number of reactions to this, Mary. And there's the cynical part of me. There's the hopeful part of me, and then there's the business part of me. And
which came first? The cynical.
The
part.
Cynical part.
Yes, the cynical part was the woof.
Oh, yeah, that was the woof.
Okay.
All right. And the cynical part of me is a little unfair because the same day that this announcement was made, the same day, HBO put out their release date for House of the Dragon. And it was stunning.
What did they do, Blake, for those of us who haven't seen it?
Right, so for House of the Dragon,
which is the Game of Thrones spinoff on HBO, who does their job,
right.
HBO.
House of the Dragon had been leading up to this moment. The HBO had been leading up to the moment of release. The previous day before the announcement, they had put out a bunch of teasers. They had let out a bunch of posters, and they essentially released the theme of what is to come. The next day, when they say, hey, our show is premiering on June 16th, what they did was is they crafted two trailers from the season. And if you're not familiar with the show, you're not going to get it. But for those of you who are familiar with the show, and by the way, go to maryandblake.com, check out House of the Dragon with Mary and Blake. You know that they split the two teasers between Team Black and Team Green, the Targaryens versus the Hightowers, and who is going to assume the... And there's a civil war between these two families about who's going to be taking over.
So they made it a fun watching experience where you got to, like, be excited even though you're getting a morsel of information. But it's a video morsel. It's someone put work into it.
Yeah, they make their fans engage with it because they say... Which side are you? Who do you believe? Who do you think is the rightful heir? Are you Team Green or Team Black? Now, I'm Team Black. I don't know about you, Mary. I'm not sure if you've decided yet.
I haven't yet.
But I'm on Rhaenyra. I'm on her side.
I think I might be Team Green.
just for the fun of it.
No, I just don't really like these creepy dragon ancestral people.
Okay. Fair enough. Fair enough. But they made it engaging,
yes.
right? And they actually actually did something, and they planned it.
Did this fun release date announcement
yes.
thing same day or like slightly,
same day?
But, okay, same day that
same
STARZ
day.
Did.
And then all of a sudden, within a few hours, mm-hmm. we get this random ass Instagram post mm-hmm. from Outlander. No
with
graphics.
Five picture stills
with
behind
five,
the scenes.
Five picture stills. Whatever. Who cares? And it's just there's no graphic. There's not even like a little mini video teaser. Nothing.
The main picture is Jamie and Claire looking mad.
Yeah, and like a camera is barely visible. And like it doesn't make any thematic sense. And then the announcement itself is random text. In like the like as
the
it's
description.
In the post.
Yes.
There's no like, hey, June 12th. Like there was, or November 24th. Like there was nothing.
No, they said November.
No, I know, but I'm saying like there was nothing in the photo.
Here, I'll read you the actual thing. So once again, the main picture is Jamie and Claire looking very pensive or thoughtful, but
yeah,
not
but whatever.
Like happy.
Who cares?
I'm just saying, okay.
But the pictures suck. They suck. There's one nice one of John Gray.
Give me some John Gray.
Yeah, okay.
I don't even... Come on! Okay, this is what they said. Back in action, Outlander Season 7, Part 2, premieres this November.
Yeah.
That's what the official STARZ post now.
It's awful.
I think it was a little bit bigger when it first came out.
It's
nonetheless
awful. It's awful. And so that right there, that
I'm gonna find out if they edited it because I know I screenshotted it for you.
That dichotomy says it speaks volumes between the two networks, right? There's an adult at the table at HBO. There's an adult there. Whether or not you agree with the adult, whether or not
in the PR department at HBO. Because
no,
here's the
thing. But Casey Bloys is an adult.
No, but I want to first take a quick moment.
Jeff Hirsch is not an adult.
We are not talking about the creative team.
Well,
no,
I'm
saying
gonna,
at this moment. At this moment, what we're talking about is the people with the posting, those people, the PR team right now.
Yeah.
Does not see it pales in comparison to the House of the Dragon announcement, which also happened.
Yeah, and
it makes it feel like someone on the STARZ PR team was scrolling Instagram and saw this amazing thing from House of the Dragon.
Exactly, and they were like,
"Oh crap!
What we got to do something?
What's our big show again?
Yeah, like what are we supposed to do now?
What it?
Oh yeah, yeah.
Shoot,
it was like some. It was like 50-year-old dude who has no idea about anything was like, let me get on this Instagram.
Watch out, man, okay?
You know 50-year-old
dude.
I didn't say 40. I said 50 for a reason, okay? Because you know if that was a 20-year-old, they would have had that figured out.
50 is still Gen X. They know
exactly how
to use social media.
No, nowhere near like us. Nowhere near like us.
Blake.
I'm just telling you.
Okay,
it's a matter of fact.
I'm a Zennial, okay?
Yes.
I'm cusper. I know how to use it.
I know, but whatever. It doesn't matter. All I'm saying is it looked like they were reacting as opposed to being proactive.
Mm-hmm.
And the way that they reacted was so poor and so ill thought out. Not well thought out, ill thought out, that it's embarrassing as an organization.
We're not even talking about the fact that it is November. Okay? That is not what we've scratched upon yet, my friends. We are just talking about the delivery of how they shared this news with us.
Yeah, it was pretty pathetic. It was pretty pathetic. All right. So that's the first part of my cynical side, right? Where it was like HBO clearly had a plan and STARZ was kind of like
had an afterthought.
It puked on its shoes when it saw what HBO did. It was like, "Oh my god, we're here." You know, like that's what happened.
They didn't even give us a GIF.
Nothing.
I couldn't pull anything together.
So, from that, and you know what? This is pretty, in my opinion, this is pretty prescriptive of STARZ. They've never been good at this. They've never done a good job. It's always been, this is what we're doing, and oh well. Sorry.
Okay, before we get even more negative, because that's where you're going, and I can feel it. For those of you who see glasses as half full, I'm here wearing my Claire season one jacket with you. I believe November is the month of gratitude.
Yep.
And I am grateful to have Outlander in my life. I'm grateful that it's at least now happening this year because we were told it was going to be this year. And by them pushing it to November makes me feel like somebody in some decision-making room was probably trying to even push it to 2025.
Yes.
If they said November, I feel like someone was like, no, we are not getting it out this year. And someone was like, throw them a bone.
And you better believe that it's going to be the end of November.
Yeah. It's going to be like Thanksgiving weekend.
Yeah.
Okay?
And there's a reason for this. And I'll get into that in a little bit. So here's what I'm going to say.
Because I feel like we've been on a negative thing. And I'm here to say I am grateful. And I am grateful that we are having Outlander continue. And
hold on, I'm going to go let our dog out. Hold on.
And that we are having
she's
season 8. She is that upset. She's red like Jamie. She's got big feelings.
She's Scottish.
She is Scottish. So I'm grateful. I don't want to come off that I'm not grateful for all of the beautiful people who have made this show what it is and have already worked so hard on the back half of season 7. That is not what this is about. But I think that it comes really down to communication.
Yeah.
That is the problem.
So let me also say this too. I love Outlander, right? I do. And I'm thankful for the show. I'm thankful for what it's done for my bride and I. I'm thankful for the community that we've all created together. And I'm happy that we got a release window, right? And I don't care that it's in November. Like, whatever. Like, it's going to be in November. That's what it's going to be.
You love watching shows that time of year.
Yeah, I do.
Like, you actually don't like when it's springtime, summertime, because
yeah,
we are out so often. Yes.
And
like, not that you were hoping that it was this time of year, but you were like, oh, it's nice to watch it that time of year.
Again, by the way, I'm not surprised at this release window. You know, Mary, this is an official comment from me. I knew
that we
had 0.0 chance of seeing this season before August.
Yes.
I knew it.
You remember telling me that you were like earliest September.
Yeah.
And here I am last fall.
Oh, March.
Being like,
maybe
no,
Easter.
They're going to come out with a new Yule log and they're going to tell us great news. It'll come out Valentine's Day weekend. And Blake was like, no, September earliest.
Mary. Earliest. And I'm on the record of saying that. So, whatever. November's November. Who cares?
I mean, a lot of people care, Blake. You can just say, I don't care.
You know what I mean? Stats are for nerds. Angela here on Facebook is saying, not even a press release. Mm-hmm. Nobody cares about press releases.
I do.
No, but the normal person, not like nerds like you and me and Angela and like most of the people on the live right now.
Okay.
They
You're
care
saying
about
casual
that.
Watchers.
But casual,
okay.
Nobody cares about a press release. Nobody's going to know. Nobody reads that stuff. So who cares? What matters is, how do you make an announcement and how do you advertise that? House of the Dragon did an amazing job. HBO, who has an adult at the table in Casey Bloys, did an amazing job. You have Jeff Hirsch over there, your boy Jeff Hirsch, guy, premium woman guy, and he's like, yeah, well, you know, he's like Frankie Pantangeli in The Godfather 2, because it always goes back to The Godfather. Hey, Michael Corleone said this, Michael Corleone said that, and I was like, yeah, sure. That's what Jeff Hirsch is. And it's disappointing, right? The way that all of this was handled.
Mm-hmm.
But what I'm saying is, I'm thankful for Outlander, and I'm happy that we have I love the show, and I'm happy that we have a window, right? But the execution of all of this is very poor. And the other cynical part of me in this, and I have to say it, is I don't know if there's an adult at the table at the show.
What does that mean?
It means there is no chance.
The show means everybody.
Yeah.
So I'm just kind of confused.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. There is no chance.
You're saying anyone executive level and up?
Yeah, at the show.
Okay.
Like someone who's running the day-to-day stuff there.
Okay, so you're talking Matt and Merrill?
Matt and Merrill.
Okay.
There is no chance, 0.0 chance, that someone like... you know, the Duffer Brothers or Damon Lindelof or
Ron Moore.
Taylor Sheridan or even Ron Moore.
Would this have happened under Ron's watch?
No.
No,
are you telling me that there would be just this random Instagram post of some...
Once again, the communication.
Yeah, no. So that's what I'm saying. There's not an adult at the table at the show to be like, whoa, time out. What are we doing? This is my show. Yes, I know STARZ, you're the network and whatever, but this is my show.
Because here's the scoop. You're going to talk in a moment about why you thought way back when that it wouldn't be coming until fall 2024.
Yes.
The date of it being released is what it is. What I think a lot of us are upset about is the lack of communication, the lack of professionalism, the lack of kind of... loving on the fans who've been waiting and who now need to continue to wait a lot longer without giving a bit more of an experience to this announcement, because you think that there's very clear reasons as to why it's a November release date, Blake.
Yeah, absolutely.
And so that's why I'm saying, like, I cannot wait. I hope that there's a little snitch somewhere in this PR mess that's going to let us know eventually exactly why it had to be pushed so late. And then also why they just didn't communicate that. Because if there are very clear reasons, which Blake's going to start to delve into what he thinks it was, if there were truly reasons that this could not air anytime before November 2024, they could have let us understand that and digest that a little bit more and still done fun little celebrations all the while.
Mm-hmm.
And I really think that while over the past few years, the Outlander fandom has gone through so much turnover and has also been divided in so many ways that they kind of really owed this to the fans just to keep a little magic. Keep a little magic for us. So, Blake, why do you think that this was, unless you were going on a different bit, but I think that you really had some clear points, because a lot of people saying, why November? You know, they gave us this very vague 2024.
Yes. So officially, like this whole early 2024 thing that people were saying is a bunch of malarkey. Like, I think that, like, there's been said, oh, Meryl let it slip or whatever. Like, no, officially.
That you can find.
That, like, you point me to an article where this was said.
Okay.
And I'll gladly say otherwise.
Yes, but as of now, what you have been able to find.
Officially from STARZ and from the show, it was always 2024. There was no indication that it was going to be early, late, mid. It was just 2024. Again, part of the cynical thing is, it's like, okay, Matt Roberts is the showrunner for Outlander. He's also the showrunner for the spinoff show that's filming right now.
Yes.
And by the way, they're starting to film Outlander Season 8 right now, too.
Yes. And he hasn't been cloned to what we know. Like, Matt Roberts hasn't been cloned.
how can you, like, I know that there are people who run multiple shows at a time, like, obviously. But you can't run this many shows all at once, effectively, with your eyes on the ball and everything. On top of the fact that we had the WGA strikes.
Okay, so let's go back to that. We had strikes that lasted
for a while.
A very long time. And two different layers of these strikes.
Right.
We had the Writers Guild strike.
And then we had the actors.
Then the actors.
The Screen Actors Guild.
The Screen Actors Guild strike.
Yes.
And all of that took Hollywood
out
to a standstill.
I mean, a complete, utter stop. And everything was postponed. Now, there are a bunch of nerds out there that are going to say, well, CS7B was already in the can. It shouldn't matter. It does matter. Because just because the thing has been shot.
But just think that it was shot before the strike. Just digest that while your heart breaks for a moment.
Yeah. Just because the thing was shot doesn't mean that it's done. Any film, any television show, the thing is created in the editing bay.
Think about it like grocery shopping, okay?
Yes.
You're planning Thanksgiving dinner. The filming is your grocery shopping. It's the planning of your grocery list.
Yep.
It's the going to the store. It's getting the items and bringing it home and putting it on your kitchen island. But then the editing bay is actually making the meals out of it.
Yeah.
It's that big of a deal.
And guess who is the primary force, except for the editors and, you know, the editing, the people who run the board.
Yeah.
Who is the primary moving force in the editing bay, Mary?
The lead chef. What is the lead chef called in Ratatouille? What's, like, the actual lead chef in the kitchen called? Chef.
Yeah. Sure, chef.
That guy.
No.
It's Matt Roberts.
It's Matt Roberts. It's the showrunner. The showrunner can't work, even as an editor, because it's alluding and it is also indirectly involved with the aspect of writing. Like, okay, there are people in the groups here. The WGA strike did not affect 7B that much. Meryl took over post-production for that. And in August, Meryl said, I have the articles for her that season 7 was almost finished post-production.
And that is in August, Meryl saying that.
That's great. But the problem is, it still needs to be finished. Are you telling me that Matt Roberts isn't going to be part of that editing bay? Are you, like, it's bananas.
So we think
it's banana land.
So
to
we
think.
Know that the strikes
there's
push
a delay.
Things back.
That's
we know
that's
that Matt Roberts being pulled in three different directions at once, in addition to whatever else is going on in his life.
Yeah.
Maybe he has a hobby. I don't know. I'd hope he has a hobby by now, because his hobby's just been Outlander for a decade. You know, he's being pulled in all these different directions.
Mm-hmm.
But what would make it this long? Because they did film it. They had been doing most of the editing. A lot of people are saying that they thought 7 was going to be it, final season, And then they went about and said, nope, never mind. We're going to do season 8. And so there might have been some reshoots, some rewriting. But this is a ginormous Droughtlander.
Mm-hmm.
Are there other elements that you can think of that would make this be delayed till November?
Yes.
Okay.
There is.
Tell me.
All right. So I'm going to give you the hopeful creative side of me.
Ooh, an optimistic side to Blake. Pigs are flying everywhere.
All right. So the creative side of me is thinking this. You have Outlander season 7.
Mm-hmm.
You're shooting it. It's
A,
there.
B?
B. It's
because they're not the same thing. They've made that very clear with this giant break.
So, is they're shooting the spinoff right now.
Mm-hmm.
The creative part of me is thinking, well, wouldn't it be nice?
Wouldn't it be nice
to have like a backdoor pilot almost?
Mm-hmm.
Wouldn't it be nice to have some of the cast or mm-hmm. characters in your prequel show up in your main show? Right? So, and I'm thinking, how are you able to do that, right? Well, you're able to do that because you have Roger and Buck going back in time. Right, at the end of season 7A.
Mm-hmm. So you're thinking now, like, because they had gotten the cast of Blood of My Blood and everything, that you're thinking, let's wiggle. Remember, of course, friends in the comments, Blake hasn't read anything.
Mm-hmm.
So he knows what the show has shown him, and he knows that there's a prequel and who that prequel is about. But aside from that, let's make sure that there's no spoilers.
Yeah.
That can be happening.
Is there, we know the prequel is happening. We know around whom the prequel is focused, right?
Yes.
Just because Roger and Buck decide, hey, I'm going back, that doesn't mean they go back to the timeline that they're supposed to go. Is it possible that Roger and Buck go too far back in time and they happen to run into Jamie's parents? Is it fair to say that they do? I don't know. I've never read the books. I couldn't tell you. But I'm saying creatively, as a showrunner, this is how they used to do things back in the day, where they would have backdoor pilots. And they'd be like, okay, I got these characters. These are spinoff characters. I want to spin this off into a new show. Let's have them show up in my main show, give them an episode, and then we create a new show around that. Is that what they're going to do? I don't know. But is there a possibility? Is there a cool creative reason to do that? Yeah, there is. You got the prequel shooting right now. Matt Roberts is the showrunner right now. Just because it's locked, in quotes, doesn't mean a damn thing. They can do whatever the hell they choose. They didn't have to deliver anything to STARZ yet. And I know that because, remember, when we were when we had This Is Us 2, by the way, go to marianblake.com, listen to This Is Us 2 if you like This Is Us, which is streaming on Netflix. We spoke to the editors, and they were like, yeah, oh, yeah, we were editing the premiere of season, the final season, until the day before it aired.
Yes.
And they were like, we weren't sure we were going to have it ready. So just because it's locked, it doesn't mean jack. They can do anything that they choose.
Aloha Mora.
Right. So that, to me, is the fun creative side.
Okay.
Right?
I like this optimistic, like, let's get funky with it.
Yeah, do you think that... I think there's an opportunity there to make it fun.
I appreciate this very interesting idea of yours.
I doubt that they'll do it.
Oh.
I doubt it.
Mm-hmm.
But I think that it would be nice to do.
Okay.
The problem, aside from there not being an adult at the table at the show, and there not being an adult at the table at STARZ, I think what's happening is far more sinister.
Oh my God, you just said like a massive adjective that I was not expecting.
And
sinister.
Yeah, and I say sinister because it's business related. And that's my other take.
Okay. I mean, I'm sitting here in a Claire's riding coat sitting next to a stuffed Hedwig, and you're throwing the word sinister at us.
Yeah.
Okay. What is your sinister take?
It's all about money. And it is informed by the fact that Lionsgate, which owns STARZ, is splitting itself from STARZ. It will still be owned and operated, retained by what's called Lionsgate Studios Corp.
Mm-hmm.
But Lionsgate, the studio, like the movie studio, will be separate from STARZ, the company.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it'll be its own thing. And when is that supposed to go down? That is supposed to happen. Supposed to happen by the end of April.
So this is like a divorce. You're splitting the furniture, figuring out who
well,
gets
it's
the
not
kids
a divorce. No,
day.
No, it's a very amicable, like planned, thought out
yeah.
thing that.
But who gets what timelines?
Well,
moving.
Yeah, like the film studio will retain all the rights to mm-hmm. all the films, to all, its library of things. And it will retain the IP, meaning the
so
intellectual property.
So where's the money
property.
Aspect? Where's the sinisterness in this?
Okay. All right. So let's... I have an article here. It explains it far better than me.
Okay.
Than I can sum it up for you. All right. So I will read about it. And then if you have questions, you can ask me.
Because this has been going on for a very long time. Like, this is a very known thing that the split is happening. They've been talking about this forever.
Yes. So Lisa here on Facebook says they've been working on that split for well over a year.
Yeah.
They have. They've talked about the idea of selling STARZ. However, recently, over the past few months, they've come to a conclusion that they're not going to sell STARZ. They have the potential to, still, but they're just splitting it off into its own entity as opposed to selling it. That is a recent development, and that's what is happening. So, here it is. Lionsgate is now looking at spinning off its studio business rather than kicking STARZ, the premium network and streaming business, kicking it out. The company, in an SEC filing Wednesday, said that despite the volatile market...
When was this written?
This was written 2 days ago.
Okay.
The company remains, Lionsgate remains on a path to separating our STARZ and studio businesses. However, Lionsgate is increasingly focused on divesting the studio side of the house. They've increased their focus on the possibility of spinning the studio business, creating a number of financial and strategic benefits. The company had previously announced that it was considering spinning off or selling STARZ, which it acquired in 2016, and they have some partners that they were going to work with to do that, but they stopped doing that. And they stopped those talks as of Q1 2023. And then Lionsgate has evidently concluded that the long-term economics of streaming are more attractive than the studio business. In the second quarter, STARZ's global streaming subscriber base grew by $4.8 million subscribers to 24.5 million, which was up 47% from the year earlier. And then overall, STARZ had 35.8 million customers worldwide at the end of March, up 21% year over year. So... why
Maybe
is this important?
Like that bores me.
I know. That's why.
So you don't ask me why it's important because it wasn't important
no.
to me.
Well, that's
need
why
to
I'm asking
it.
You. That's why I'm asking you as I'm reading this. You need to, if you have questions, ask them.
Why does this put it into why do I care? Tell me, sum this up for me, teach.
Okay. So, your boy Jeff Hirsch is back.
Oh, yes, he
Jeffrey
is.
Jeffrey Premium Woman Hirsch.
He's one. So, he's still here. Making great decisions, Jeff.
I say all of this stuff to lead up to this.
Mm.
With STARZ set to become a pure play, standalone public company by the end of the year, CEO Jeffrey Premium Woman Hirsch is out talking up its strong points and how it competes in a crowded streaming landscape. Price increases and bundling, and most importantly, he said, containing content costs. With a slate of new shows in development as later season series get costly. Meaning, Outland is just too much frackin' money. because it's been going on for 8 seasons.
Claire keeps wearing the same clothes. Give her a break, okay? Reduce, reuse, recycle. I'm kidding.
This comes directly from Jeffrey Premium Woman Hirsch. He says, when seasons go from 1 to 2 to 3 to 4 seasons, 3 to 4 is where the cost really pops because most of the actors, they get bigger raises. And you have to really manage that. So you have to have in your portfolio development shows that can actually replace shows as they get into later seasons, he said at the Deutsche Bank meeting conference the other day, providing one of the most blunt assessments of a practice introduced by Netflix and embraced by other streamers where shows produced under the cost-plus model are often canceled after 3 to 4 seasons when they get too expensive. Mm-hmm. As you turn the slate over to go from seasons 4 to 5 economics to season 1 economics, you can pull a ton of cost out of the business. What you have to do is map out each of those shows and what the curve looks like and know where you have to pop a new show on to bring that cost down. And so we've got a pretty good map of what that looks like. Because, again, we focus on these two core demos, which have been able to manufacture hits for those demos.
Oh, tell me, Jeffrey. Those are your demos.
It's the premium woman. Hey! Over here, it's the premium woman.
She's premium.
And, you know, they're an underserved demo, I'll tell you.
That's why the premium.
And they're premium because, hey, look at me, I'm premium, and I'm giving them the goods. Right? And he goes on to say, and so when you look at a show like BMF, which is Black Mafia Family, that they're now premiering, mm-hmm. you know, BMF will be probably one of our two biggest shows, okay? It looks a lot like Power. It costs half as much, right? And you look at the power map and say, okay, if I take one of those characters out and spin one of those out, I can bring it on to replace the power show at half the cost.
I love that he's just sharing all this.
I know. Now, I'm putting a lot of money right to the bottom line, eh? And I'm really not losing nothing in terms of acquisition costs and subscriber viewership because we know that with those demos, them premium women, what they want. And we know how to line those up. Because we're premium, too.
He doesn't think we need communication and trust.
Hey, and that's really the core. That's really the core, getting that 20% margin, turning the slate over with fresh content to drive the business. Right?
Jeffrey.
So, you say, oh, the cost-plus model, Blake. What is the cost-plus model that they, what?
Sorry, I just had a news announcement. Catherine, Princess of Wales, announces she has cancer.
Oh, my God.
Just need to say, because this is a live podcast.
Holy smokes. Oh, we got to get into that later.
Oh, I know.
The cost plus model, right? That is networks and streamers pay upfront a show's production costs plus a premium, typically about 30% of the costs. Then there are bumps and bonuses after each season for talent. And while the payments are relatively modest after season 1 and a little bit bigger after season 2, they usually escalate after season 3 as the studios start to pay off the show's back end. Production costs also increase with each season. He said, even after the separation of STARZ and Lionsgate's studio business, the Lionsgate brand will continue to be valuable to the ongoing success of our international platform. Four stars. Mm-hmm. Okay. Ultimately, what I'm trying to say here is they have to make sure that STARZ has enough people subscribing and maintaining the already big profits that they're getting from the TV side of the business, which is why they're separating the film studio from the TV business.
Okay.
Your boy Jeffrey Hirsch is trying to turn STARZ into the next Netflix. And he's trying to go by the model that Netflix has created. Mm-hmm. Again, once again, no adult at the table because they're reacting as opposed to creating something new. Mm-hmm. They're saying, oh, Netflix does that. We want to do that. And what they're doing is they're saying we need to have content so that when the company does split itself, we will be able to maintain those margins that we've created and get more subscribers and keep the TV business going, keeping the momentum going in towards a Netflix type model, Mary. So this leads me to look at, okay, well, what's STARZ doing over the next few months?
Not few, Blake. Several. Okay, it's only March.
Whatever. What they're trying to do is they're trying to lower their costs, as we've talked about. Mm-hmm. They're trying to maintain enough content. They're trying to prop up the business so that when they do break off, they can keep the stock prices where it's supposed to be. And then they'll have enough momentum to go forward. So now looking at the release schedule that we have for STARZ. March 1st, BMF is a brand new show, season one, coming out. It's low cost. That will take them 10 episodes all the way up through March, April, May. But guess what they're doing in April? They're overlapping it with another limited series, which is a limited cost called Mary and George. Mm-hmm. Mary and George STARZ Julianne Moore, who's an Oscar winner. It's a big deal. There's actually a lot of hype for Mary and George as an Emmy contender. The ratings for it on Rotten Tomatoes are through the roof. It's 94%. It is in line. It's in that same time period of King James I. This is like their wheelhouse. This is like their type of thing, right? June 7th.
What about May?
Well, that takes us through May.
Okay, Mary and George go through
May. Mary and George take us through May. Okay. June 1st, Power, Book 2, Ghost, Season 4A, the final season, begins. September 6th, Power, Book 2, Ghost, Season 4B, begins. That takes us through September. We have another to be determined.
Then put Outlander there.
We have another series that is yet to be determined when it's going to be released. It's called Three Women. That is also going to be coming out. That will take us through October. And then, now we have November.
Okay, but why wouldn't they put an already successful show still in that network? Because when people are watching it, they'll say, oh, what else is this other show?
Agreed. But they know that all of you nerds out there that are saying, I'm pissed off on Outlander. I'm canceling my subscription.
Yeah.
They know that you're coming back. They're like Red Sox. You Outlander nerds, us Outlander nerds, are like Red Sox fans right now. I'm a Red Sox fan, and I am pissed with how the team is playing. And I didn't really care about it. But when they stop playing in the regular season, you better be sure that I'm going to be watching those games again because I love the Red Sox. I'm a diehard.
So they don't care that they're going to lose March through October money?
They're not losing nothing because they have Power, by the way, is a far more successful show than Outlander. Mm-hmm. Far more. And they're going to have Mary and George, which is going to be an Emmy contender. It is like that is what it's being slated
as. Do they not need Outlander?
No, they need Outlander, but it's not as important as we're all making it out to be. It is an important piece of IP, which is why they're continuing to make these shows.
But it's not as important to them as we think it should be.
No, they want to be out of the Outlander business. Not the world, the Outlander business. Because it's too much money.
Because Jeff it's gone Hirsch on for said so it. Long. Okay.
He said it right then and there. So what he's saying is, we need this show to prop up the stock price, but we also have all these other shows that were slated.
Jeffrey.
So what we're going to do, here's the thing. And this is why it kind of all ties back a little bit. And this is why I kind of got the idea about the backdoor pilot thing. Because you put off Outlander until November. That guarantees that you're going to get content. And that's why I say the end of November. Because it guarantees you subscribers by the end of the year, which that's when the quarter fiscal quarter ends. And it puts more subscribers for you into the year 2025. Having said that, what if they release 7B?
They're going to start the series back over. They're going to start the series back over and line it up in time to cover that to be determined time. Because if they do it every single day, maybe have a new episode air on STARZ. Can they do that?
Yeah. There's no reason
that
why
takes you into the end of the summer. The end of the summer through brings you up to November.
Right. And then what I'm saying is the backdoor pilot aspect of it
leads
you right up to the new show. Right? It leads you right up to the prequel. And then that leads you right up to the final season. And then the final season gives way. Outlander goes on its way. We have Blood of My Blood. It's a brand new show, low costs. I get to stay in the same world. All you Outlander nerds are going to stick with STARZ. And now I'm good to go. And if I feel like doing a Lord John series or a Fergus series or a Master Raymond series, I can. I'll figure it out. But they needed to get across this line, this bump of April or May. You know, you have to build in time in case something goes wrong. And then still have enough content to get you into the next year, to bridge that gap. And Outlander is that
jerks.
Gap. And that's the business.
So that's Blake's business. I wouldn't call it sinister, because that to me is like
evil. It's just,
but it's just like a selfish business.
Yeah, they just don't care about you.
But here's the thing.
Well, they don't.
Okay, business is business, right?
Yes.
Businesses need to run. They need to be profitable, but they need to be able to pay the actors, build the sets, do what they do. But here's where I have a problem, because I can appreciate that to a certain degree. I can appreciate the business model of like, how are we going to continue to make this thrive and grow? And I appreciate the Outlander has become more expensive, and they want to make way for new shows and spinoffs and less expensive productions. But then why lead us on in such a way that, I will tell you, they led us on. And it wasn't just us, because members of the cast, Nell Hudson, put down that she was shocked. Diana Gabaldon, who...
Oh, don't get me started on Diana.
Yes. Diana.
Don't get me started on Diana.
Wonderfully witty way.
Oh.
Starts it with excellent, right?
Well, she said exciting.
Exciting. That's what it is. But then throws a little thing like about there not being an exact date.
Oh, are we surprised?
Are we surprised? Well done. See, so I'm telling you that there's like key people, not key people, but like people who've even been in the creation of the show, including the creator of the universe, being a little like, okay, like we got it. We didn't really get it. Nell Hudson saying like, wow, that's a long time to wait.
Yeah.
And us just as even the casual viewer can sit down and say, this was not the best PR move. This was not the best announcement. They could have done such a different job. And that's why I'm saying like they could have done a fun teaser trailer.
Yes.
And done it on the spring equinox. They could have done something around Christmas time with a flipping little CGI Yule log, okay, and made us feel good. They could have done something cute at Valentine's Day. They could have just they could have used the easy button.
They could have used
of the
freaking
pandemic
sock puppets
and
done something
and
funny.
They could have said the pandemic and the writer's strike has made this delayed, but it's going to be worth the wait.
Yes.
And here's a little teaser. They could have done something that still we would have been like, are you kidding me? It's going to be November. We have to wait even longer, but at least it would have done us as fans justice, and it wouldn't have cost that much money.
No.
It just would have been someone giving a flying Fig Newton about the Outlander fans.
Right. And
who's in that echelon. Because once again, it's not Diana, it's not Meryl, it's not Matt. They all love the community.
They love the fandom.
It's the Jeffrey Hirsches.
But also part of me looks at that and says, there's still not an adult there because they got no control over what's being done for their show.
But that's why, like, I'm hopeful. I'm really hopeful that, like, some person, some little assistant who isn't in those meetings, like, was Meryl there banging her fist on the table? Was Matt crying? Come on, Jeffrey!
Maybe.
You know, that's what I want to know. I want to know that they were fighting for us. I want to know that they had our back. I want to know that, you know, Sam and Kat were like, are you kidding me?
Maybe they did, and let's just say that they did.
I just want that in my heart.
And this is why I look at this.
I want to know
say,
that they care as much as we do, because I know they do.
This is why I look at this announcement as reactionary, right? Because someone who loves this show and loves the fandom, which we think Meryl and Rob and
we know they
Matt
do. You need to stop saying we think. We know they do.
Okay, fine, they do. you know that they would have a better plan, right? Like, you, at least that you would hope. But they don't have enough of their finger on the pulse because they're so busy doing Blood of My Blood that there's, like, there's no communication between the network and the showrunner, which to me is inexcusable. And you can tell because there's just no plan there. There was nothing. STARZ itself didn't even have the wherewithal to create an actual campaign of anything. They just put out these random ass pictures, which were bad pictures, and they put it in the text of the post. So part of me thinks that they just don't know what they're doing. They don't know what they're doing. And I look at it like when Diana was like, Are we surprised? Like, you could interpret it any way you want. I interpreted it like, are we surprised from STARZ? Like, are we surprised that they don't have a plan?
No, Diana,
I'm not surprised. But the problem is, this is your show. Like, and she's not the showrunner, but she's the creator of this world.
I know, but there's only so much she can do.
But I know.
And that's why I think she had to be like, oh, yay.
But you see, the actors and all these, like, I don't blame them for being like, whoa, I'm surprised by this. Like, it should be a lot sooner. Why isn't it sooner? Because they don't know. They're just actors. Nell Hudson.
They did their job so long ago on these episodes that they're like, are you kidding me? Like, it still isn't done.
Nell Hudson probably got a bunch of DMs and was like, oh, holy smokes, really? Like, I filmed that like 2 years ago or whatever. And she's not a producer. She doesn't know any of this stuff. She doesn't work with STARZ. She just shows up, reads the script, and see you later. So I don't blame her for having that kind of post. I blame Diana for having that
post. Why?
Because this is your show. Do not throw your network or your show.
What are they going to do? Stop?
I know.
She's got cojones, okay?
If she turned around and said, guys, I know it's a little while, but trust me, 7B.
Wait, who she is.
But hold on. 7B is going to be great. It's really exciting. I love what I saw. There would be zero reaction from the fans. If Diana stepped in and said, don't worry about it, guys. It's going to be all set.
No.
All this vitriol would either one, go away, or two,
they would say, who wrote your post? Because that is not Diana writing that post.
That is not how
she would respond.
I think.
You're just surprised that this is happening. But, you know, I am not surprised that that is how she wrote it. And I don't think that if she had come out all sunflowers and roses that it would quell the reactions. And like you and I said in the very beginning of this podcast episode, Blake, the reactions to this news has been so different.
It's all
And
over
we need
the
to
place.
Be careful with how long we go because we do have children.
Yes.
It has been amazing. Like, there have been people who have been like, thank goodness, like, I'm so excited, I love the fall, I'm so glad it's still coming out in 2024. Some Outlander is better than no Outlander. Obviously they've taken great care to work on this, and we love our cast and our crew. And that's the thing that I think Blake and I want to really make sure, from our perspective, anything of our frustration is not against the cast and the crew and the creative people who've made this show. It really comes down to, like, the people in this corporate office who decided to have such a mismatched way of communicating with the fandom. And it really just seems like they do not appreciate this fandom and how devoted we have been.
But you see, the thing is, and I've seen some people in our comments be like, oh, well, they're going to lose all my money from now between whenever I resubscribe. You're right. But how many more people are going to subscribe in between then because of
the other shows,
BFM and all these other shows, Mary and George? It's going to be huge. They don't care about Outlander or the fans of Outlander. Like, they don't care about BFM or the fans of BFM or Mary. They don't care. As long as the top line sales stay the same or grow.
Mm-hmm.
Whether or not Outlander nerds, and you know, Mary, we have all these subscriptions. You don't even know half of them.
What do you? Because I tell you to cancel them.
I know, but like, you got Peacock, and then you got STARZ, and then you got Amazon, and then you got Netflix, and then you got Max, and then you got all freaking, you might as well just have cable again. What I'm saying is, they know half the time that most of you nerds won't cancel the thing, because you'll forget. You'll forget.
Jeffrey Hirsch.
So...
Okay, so we have some reactions, because once again, we have to get ready to go get our kids. We're getting all fired up.
Yeah.
I'm excited in the sense that it's happening. God forbid. I've been waiting every single holiday, every single special stone day, birthdays. I've just been waiting for a pebble of excitement. So for us to have gotten a pebble of excitement... And to know it's happening, and to know that it's happening, for a lot of us, a very special, magical, lovely time of year when you do want to snuggle in and watch a show. I'm grateful. You know what? Maybe this gives them more time to make it even better. Okay? I'm grateful for that.
Yes.
I'm mad at Jeffrey and his team.
Yeah. I would co-sign with you on that one. All right, Marvin, you want to do anything?
Do we have any reactions that you wanted to read?
I mean, I got a billion, but the problem is it's now.
Okay, so we're gonna need to have a part two of this.
We might have to have a part.
Okay,
two.
We're gonna have to have a part two of this because we asked for your reactions and we got so many of them because just like us, you have so much to say about this.
Yeah, your voice is just as valid as ours.
Yes, because none of us is right.
No,
you know, we all have our own relationship with Outlander. We all have our own opinions about how this is being handled. And like I said, overall, I am a glass half full. I know that I did not sound that on this podcast episode, but I wanted to get to the why. I wanted to get to the why, as I do not feel like I, as a fan and the fandom in general, I just don't feel like we have been respected for the amount of blood, sweat, tears, and love that we have poured in.
Yep.
And I just, that is where I am upset. I am excited for the show. I love the show. I love the characters. I love all of it, okay? I just don't think that the fandom was, that this was treated with the respect that we deserved. So.
It was a bad PR move. I mean, regardless of respect or whatever, like, they should have, they should have just done more. To make it bigger. To make it, like,
special.
Guess what's happening.
Give me some magic.
That's why it's a guarantee this was a reaction as opposed to something planned.
Otherwise, it would have been done.
House of
the
Dragon
Equinox.
Now has a date. And House of the Dragon finished just about the same time as Outlander. What are we talking about? What are we talking about? And the date is in June. Like, that's why it's a reaction. It has to be. There's no other explanation. None. All right. Sorry, I'm all worked up now.
I know.
I'm all worked up. All right, you ready to close this bad boy out?
Yes, I am.
All right, well, hopefully we'll have a part two. Hopefully we'll have a part two.
We're going to have a part two.
Okay.
We need to hear all what right. they say.
All
listener
right.
feedback all
right.
of this.
All right, so everybody, if you do have some thoughts about what we said or what STARZ is doing or anything, please go to maryandblake.com. And click on the voicemail button there and leave us a voicemail. Write us an email, maryandblakemedia@gmail.com. Or... you can write comments on this post. Oh, hold on. There we go. I was getting a phone call. Sorry.
Okay.
You can write comments on this post or whatever. All right. So, Mary, let's close this bad boy out.
Tracks from Bear McCreary in the back half of season 7. That stuff that he gave us was magic, but I needed more. I needed more. So, Bear, if you're listening, if you made it this far.
I know.
We love you and we want more, okay? You got time. You got time for
all the time in the world,
right.
Man.
Friends, thank you so much for tuning in for this impromptu podcast episode. My name's Mary.
My name is Blake.
And you have been listening to Outlander Cast.
Except you, Jeffrey Hirsch. You can't listen to Outlander Cast. You've been banned. Banned? I officially ban you. I rebuke you. Officially. Jeffrey Hirsch. Hey!
Okay, we gotta go get
Okay, all right, I'm sorry.
All right, bye, guys. Bye.